Here we go.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world of hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a bright day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Good morning, everyone. Hello. Are you glad to be here this morning? Yes. So I want to announce a little something. For those of you who feel comfortable when you're seated, you do not have to wear a mask. Woo! So, next thing. I have been diagnosed with an eye problem. Who else has had eye problems? Yes. Oh, I'm so glad you're going to relate. My symptoms have sounded something like this. I am always right. I don't think that's important. I deserve that apology. Why don't things ever work out like I want them to? I'm so glad you relate. So luckily, I found the cure. It's a little affirmation mantra. We're going to say it together today. Are you up for it? Okay, here we go. I have sinned and fall short. I can't help myself, but by grace I have been saved. Through faith, I don't get to brag about it. When I do a few good deeds, I don't get to brag about it. It stays a gift from God for me to share the grace every day. We'd like to welcome you to church this morning. I'm going to get our song team to come up with me, and let's just praise God a little bit for all the things that He's done for us, and just put work, life, family, problems aside, and let's just give God all the praise.
So good morning, everyone. I also welcome you. This is the part where you get to stand up and join us as we sing. And bouncing off that thought, I want to share with you a verse out of Romans chapter 8. He who spared not His own Son, but freely gave Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? So we're going to sing about that. We're going to talk and sing about the fact that with God, all things are possible. This is where you have to bring your A game, people. This is an up-tempo song. Stand up, get excited.
Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my safe refuge, no other. shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy, and I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. When I am weak, you make me strong. When I'm poor, I know I'm rich, for in the power of your name.
Let's go.
Here we go.
All things are possible. All things are possible.
Let's sing it out.
All things are possible. All things are possible. Your feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord, when you fill my life with greater joy, and I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. When I am weak, you make me strong. When I'm poor, I know I'm rich, for in the power of your name, all things are possible.
How many things?
All things are possible.
Are you sure?
All things are possible.
Sing it like you mean it.
All things are possible.
Let's do it again.
All things are possible. All things are possible.
It's true.
All things are possible. All things are possible.
We are living in challenging times, and one of the things that we are having to face right now is to believe the word of God, that God is going to make a way. We have it pretty easy here in Queensland. There's other parts of Australia that don't. But even in our day-to-day lives, who knows what's going to happen from a day-to-day basis? We need to stand on the word of God, where he says all things are possible.
Amen.
And God is in control, so please join us as we sing this song that just centers down on that thought, that God is for us.
Help me out.
We won't fear the battle, we won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side. We will go before us, you will lead the way. We have found a refuge, only you can say. Sing with joy now, how God is with us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Even when I stumble, even when I fall, even when I turn back, still your love is sure. You will not abandon, you will not forsake. You will cheer me onward with never-ending grace. Sing with joy now, how God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?
nor death can separate us. Hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave his son to free us holds me in his love.
Let's sing it again.
Neither height nor depth can separate us. Hell or death will not defeat us. He who gave his son to free us holds me in his love. Sing with joy now, our Father's for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?
Great to see all your beautiful faces. My name is Pastor Mike, if you don't know me. Glad you're here. If you're visiting, for wherever you're from, we're glad to have you worshiping with us today. We've got a theme for the year. It's called Walking the Way. Walking the Way. And we've got hats. Who would wear a hat, a Walking the Way hat? Huh? Come on. I've only got six, so... Now, you got to wear it, and when people ask you, what is that about? It's not heavily religious, but there is a cross there walking the way. Okay, going that way. Oh, boy, I'm not a very good thrower, am I? All right, one more. Whoa. Okay, I would just like to invite a very special couple up. We've got Kim and Matthew Ace. Can you guys come forward? Oh, you are here. Good. I hadn't seen you, so I wasn't 100% sure you were here. Can you just come up? Because these guys have just gotten married. They've just tied the knot a couple weeks ago. And as a church family, we just want to tell you guys how happy we are for you. And that as a church, we just celebrate, as you saw already, it just erupted in applause. Because, you know, there's nothing like seeing love and seeing people, you know, beginning their lives together. And life's always got its challenges and ups and downs. But, you know, when you've got each other and you've got God, what more do you need, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know if you want to say anything. We'll give you the opportunity. If you want to say anything, you don't have to.
I'll just thank you so much for all your support over the years. I know I've been here for a number of years now. I think 2018 is when I became a member. I don't remember.
At least, yeah.
But yeah, just thank you, everyone, for your wonderful love and support.
Yeah. And these guys, I think they got married out in Somerset, right? And you managed to get it without restrictions interrupting too much and things. So we're just happy that you had a good occasion. And as a church, you know, what can we do for these guys? Well, all we can all do is just pray for them. Pray for them as a couple as they begin their lives together. And I'm just going to pray over them too, as we just really ask for God's blessing on your lives together as you go forward. Let's bow our heads. Lord in heaven, I just thank you for Matthew and Kim. We thank you that you brought them together, and we just pray as they begin their lives together that they will know that you're always there for them. As long as they keep looking to you, you're going to help them to face whatever trials and tribulations they might face. And we just pray that their love for each other and their love for you will get them through anything they face. And so, Lord, just as a church, we just thank you that they're part of our community here. May we as a church support them. And we just pray that they'll have just many exciting things ahead of them as they do life together. And so we now just pray for a special blessing of your Spirit on them. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, God.
One of the special things that we get to do each week, apart from pray for newlyweds, is to give back to the Lord. And our special offering today is for a church, a sister church of ours called Chinchilla. And they've had a few things that have needed to be improved in their church, things that for their foundations are starting to come a little bit unstuck. And so this offering would have been taken up at Big Camp, but because of obviously extenuating circumstances, we're not having Big Camp. So all the churches have been asked to give deep to help this church so that they can continue to keep meeting. You will have seen some photos behind me. And so let's pray over that as we ask the deacons to come forward. You will also be able to give online, and you just need to scroll down into and hit Chinchilla and give your offering. Thank you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this amazing church. Father, I just pray that they will get the funds that they need in order to improve what they have currently, Lord, so it's a sound and solid foundation. Father, we thank you for the work that they are doing. I just pray for your blessing over them in Jesus' name. Amen.
During Jesus' time on earth, he prayed a lot. He knew that prayer would keep him close to God, his Father. Sometimes Jesus would pray with others, like when he asked Peter, James, and John to come with him to a mountain to pray. Other times, Jesus would leave his disciples and pray by himself so he would have time alone with his Father. When Jesus prayed, he prayed for all sorts of things. He prayed for his disciples, for those in need of healing, and for little children. Jesus even prayed for us and asked his Father to watch over us. That's right, Jesus prayed for you and for me. Through Jesus' prayers, we can learn how to pray too. Jesus used the Lord's Prayer to teach his disciples to pray. It wasn't long and fancy. He showed them that they could pray in a simple way about many different things. Our prayers can be the same way. Jesus also taught us that we should pray without giving up. God is always listening to what we say. The way he answers our prayers might be different from what we expect, but we can always trust his plan for us. So the next time you're happy or sad, or worried or angry, or just need help, talk to God about it. He listened to his son's prayers, and he'll listen to yours too.
Good morning, everybody. It's time for the children's story. So, because I can't invite you down, I've decided that I'm going to choose out a couple of people to come and help me today. They have to have scissor safety skills. So, I was thinking that I might choose someone that normally comes up for the story very eagerly. I was wondering if Ethan would like to come. Okay, and then I need someone else maybe to show him up a little bit. So I need, let's go a girl. Someone hiding behind here from school. Kira, would you like to have a go? No. She's running away. Maybe Hannah. Come on, please. Thank you, Hannah. You can come on this side. Okay, let's social distance. You have a piece of paper in front of you and a pair of scissors so you can take your instruments. And I have a task for you. Jessie, my helper, is going to time you for 1 minute. and you have to complete this task. Okay? I'll show you. This is what it looks like. This is your piece of paper, and I was able to cut your piece of paper and keep it in one so that it looks like this. So that's your job. So think about it. I should have given it to you first to have a look at. You can have a look. So that's what you have to do. Let's show everybody. Yeah. Do you want me to sit in the middle? Okay. That's what you have to do. Really easy. It took me maybe 5 seconds. Just saying. Okay. Are you ready? Get your piece of paper. Time ready? Just wait for them to pick up their scissors and paper. Ready? Set. Go. How are you going? Very confident. Yep. Well, let's have a look. Does it look the same? Not quite. Not quite. Yeah, how are we going for time, Jesse? Okay. Okay, can we pause it there, Jess? Okay. I'm going to allow you, like, I've got another set of paper and scissors. I'm going to allow you to choose whoever you like to come and help you and see if you can solve it. You can choose anyone in this room. You can have an adult. Okay. So we've got Lockie coming down on this side. Who would you like, Hannah? Someone really good with scissors skills. Problem solver. Jesse. Dad, come on down. Yes, you have good scissor skills. It's all yours. Jesse, stay out of it. He's wrecking my story. You have to take the piece of paper and the scissors, and you're helping Hannah solve the problem. That's what you have to get. Lockie, did you see? I hope you haven't seen this before. Oh, my gosh. Okay, you ready? Jesse, let's do a whole minute for them. I think they need a minute. Okay, let's go. More paper. Another one. Oops. Yeah, that's more. Well, how are we going for time, Jess? We're halfway. 30 seconds to go. Don't freak out. Oh, I hope they don't get it. Oh, my gosh. Oh, yes. You did it. Oh, you wrecked my whole story. You shouldn't have come. He was able to do it. The whole idea was that you weren't supposed to be able to do it and that you forgot to ask the creator when you were asked to come to the space. Yeah. So the idea is that they weren't able to achieve it and they forgot to ask the creator. And I think so much of our time in our life, we forget to go to the creator, and we need to be reminded of that, and we have to be joyful and thankful to him and pray at all times. Thank you.
I have a very special lady to introduce you to. Her name is Maureen, and she is head of our prayer ministry team, and she has a wonderful few things that she would like to share with you.
Okay. Isn't our God awesome? And I'm sure each one of you has a number of stories where God has personally intervened in your lives. And we very much care about that. So as well as our prayer corner, we have a few new initiatives we'd like to share with you. Because each one of you as our church family are valuable to us, we are going to, as the prayer team and also the pastoral team, we want to pray for different families each week. So you'll be receiving an email, and there'll be the opportunity to let you know that we'll be praying for your family during this week. And we are also giving you the opportunity to share with us at that time any specific requests that you have. So that's another area. Now, out in the help desk, we also have this new container for your prayer requests. Now, you might think, why gold and lights? And why is it see-through? The thing is, I want you to be reminded every time you see it how precious you are to God. And how much he cares about the things that you want to pray for. So please, at the help desk, feel free to put your requests in. They will be prayed for during our prayer meeting on a Wednesday, 10 o'clock, and also during our worship service, because you're so valuable. Thank you.
So we have some prayer requests that have already been put inside. And so we would like to pray over that today. And so don't be concerned about putting them in. No names will be used, but your special requests we need to lift up to the Lord, because he tells us to pray without seeking, to continually to ask, because for his will to be done in our lives. So if you feel comfortable, close your eyes or reach your hand out, because every one of you, when we say a prayer, is in agreement over this. So if you feel comfortable, put your hands out. Otherwise, no problems if you don't feel comfortable. So let's bow our heads. Father, we lift up these prayer requests to you. Lord, you love us so very, very much that you came and you sent Jesus for us, and that he intercedes on our behalf. And we just want to lift these requests up to you. Father, families are breaking. Families are so sad. You bring us together into families, Lord. So I just pray over those that are struggling. Each one of them knows their issues, and we just lift them up to you right now. Father, we pray over concerns with COVID, with the issues that are out there, that people are struggling with, things that are going on. Lord, I just pray for peace over them. Lord, to know that you are in control. Father, you have your hand over us. Lord, we pray for those that need healing, for cancer requests. We pray and we ask in Jesus' name that it is gone from their bodies. Yes. And we thank you in advance, Father, for what you will do. Father, we pray over people's bodies that are inflamed, that are really struggling with inflammation. Father, with arthritis, Lord, and the pain, I just ask for your healing over them. Father, we thank you, we honour you, we thank you in advance, Lord, that you are going to return families that are currently overseas that can't get home to be with their children and their loved ones. Father, I just pray that you will make a path for them. Lord, we thank you. We lift these up. We thank you for all that you have done for us, for all that you will do. And we just want to honour you today and thank you in advance in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I'd like to invite you to stand with us as we worship the Lord with some more songs of worship. This is our Jesus.
There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine I can see, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is to stay. To this I Shepherd will defend me through the deepest valley. He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free. Yet not I, but through Christ.
Your death and through raising us up with you into heavenly places. Thank you.
With every breath, you know, that was just very inspirational. It's something very powerful about singing, isn't it? It's truly worship, you know, and I'm not a musical person. Most people know that, but man, you know, I've always been good at playing my radio and my CD player, and I'm very blessed by that. This week, my wife bought a new piano. And suddenly our house is really filled. It's electronic, really nice. And we got four of our family that play it, so that's pretty cool. I want to start out today. I'm going to invite Russell and Russell up. Now, these guys are, it's a little bit confusing because this is Russell Akers and this is Russell Akers. And until I realized this, I remember the first time I was ringing Russell Akers and I was trying to ring this Russell Akers and I rang this Russell Akers and I got very confused. But they are father and son, so it's Russell Akers Sr. and Russell Akers Jr. And I'm really glad to introduce them to our church. I think you guys have been here for a little while, but just tell a little bit, how long have you been here? Tell us a little bit about your family and yourself.
Yeah, I guess we came when we had border problems. Initially, we went to the Kingscliff Church, and then... Yeah, because of those issues, we decided to come here. Mm. And the big incentive, I think, for us was the fact that our two grandbabies, Trey and Ty, a lot of their friends came here because of the association from the school.
Good. Well, we're very blessed to have you, Russell. And Russell has been involved teaching Sabbath school lessons and other things here at the church. And we really value you being here. And what about the other Russell? How long have you been here? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, about the same. We sort of, came about 10 months ago, I think, and started coming. And same thing, border issues. We live at Mudroobar, and it made sense. The boys have got friends from school, from Gold Coast Christian College, that come here as well. So that made sense. And, so about 10 months or so.
So what reason that really I've gotten these guys up is because both of them have really inspired me with some amazing answers to prayer. And how many of you guys believe in prayer? Wow, that's great. Because if you don't, when we start talking today, you're going to be completely spiritually dead if you're not praying. Okay, because that's really the revelation I've gotten this week is that prayer, just like the Bible is a spiritual food, prayer is our spiritual breath. How long can you hold your breath? Okay, we're going to get into that more. But I want to just share a little bit, and I think, I know Russ Jr. was a little bit hesitant to get up, and I said, well, you don't have to speak, I can tell. But he shared the other week a story, and I was so inspired by Russell. It's nothing big, but I just want him to share his story, and also Russell Sr., because one is kind of a life or death situation. The other is just something small, but I think this really points out how God is a God who cares about the little things as well as the big things, the life things. And so I don't care who goes first. Or you go first.
Yeah, it was about 30 years ago when I was 15, And yeah, we were spearfishing at a place called Foster Tuncurry. It was a brand new spear gun basically, and it was, you know, I made it at school, and so we were spearfishing, and I tried to shoot a fish, missed, and the string line came off, and I was looking for the spear everywhere, couldn't find it. Dad then said, look, the tide was about to turn. He said, look, I'll go back and get the boat, and you know, why don't you pray about it and try and find the spear. So I thought, that's a good idea. So for the next probably 20 minutes, I'd say, I was searching and praying and say, Lord, if you're real, prove it to me. Couldn't find it. And anyway, Dad came back with the boat, and it was tied up near an oyster lease. And I'd shot, say, in this distance, like straight ahead, and the boat was at a 45 degree angle. And Dad said, how'd you go? And I said, no good. I couldn't find it, you know. So that was about half an hour. And so as I was going back towards the boat, I said, look, Lord, this is it. You know, if you're real, prove it to me. And I dived under this oyster lease, and my hands went through the weed, and I closed my eyes, and I literally popped up near the boat near Dad. And it was just a miracle. It was just like amazing. I know it was only small, it was huge to me at the time, and I've never forgotten it. And, you know, as I said, I'm nearly 46, and it still has a huge impact on me. And I think about 12 months after that, I got baptized with Pastor John O'Malley.
That's, yeah, so we know John. Yeah.
So, but it was a huge impact, and as still today, when I mention that, you know, it's because where I shot the spear and where I ended up getting it was unbelievable.
You know, it's these little things when God shows up, you know, can do tremendous things for our faith and knowing that, you know, God does exist. And, you know, I know I've prayed, God, just show yourself to me. He hasn't yet showed me himself like in a real face-to-face way. But as I look back and I'll share some of my stories today, you see that God showed himself for you and
absolutely
made a big
yeah
impact. And, yeah, and, you know, I think from what Russell says, you know, his journey, he was baptized and he kind of drifted a bit off, as many of us do. But, you know, when he came back, one of the things that led him was to remembering
absolutely
that God was there for you and that
yeah
God is
and real.
And
real,
you know,
yeah,
how important that is. Yeah. Thanks for sharing, yeah, Russell.
No, no.
And so now we're going to have Father share his story, which is a little bit, I guess, bigger in the impact of what it could be, life or death.
Pastor, this is only one part of a story in my life.
Mm.
We haven't got the time to share many things that happened in my life. God has been so gracious, so forgiving, and it's only been in probably relatively recent times when I've looked back over my life. Most of the time I didn't know he was there, but he's actually revealed to me just how he's been there in all of these steps in my life. And it's been amazing. And what I'm going to share today will be the short version of one of the dramatic things that did happen in my life. It started, I think, around about 2014 when I was diagnosed of a disease called MDS, myelodysplastic syndrome. Who's heard of that? Anyone? Okay. And basically what that is, my red blood cells, the white blood cells, and my platelets were diminishing. And in fact, it came back that I had the most severe case of MDS. And I've got to say this before I start too. During this time, 20 months, my wife stood by me and just was so marvellous, particularly I'm going ahead a bit now, the 3 months we spent in the Leukemia Foundation Village. This was after I had my transplant. Cleaning out my Hickman, for those that know what a Hickman might be. It's a thing that you put into your chest and where they give you chemotherapy and all your blood transfusions. But basically, the start of the program was when I went to the Sydney Adventist Hospital for a diagnosis because I was losing energy. And so they gave me, I'm not sure what the word was, but a bone marrow, I forget what the word, the nurses would know, but to check out really what my condition was, which proved that I had MDS. And I began having blood transfusions. They gave me needles in the tummy called Vedaza. And initially I thought that was going to cure me. Until one day the specialist said to me when I was there, I don't want you to be scared. And let me tell you, when the doctor said, I don't want you to be scared or worried, that's the time to worry.
Still shaking.
And so, but I thought that this treatment that I began would cure me. What I didn't realise was going to give me probably another 4 months before it would stop working. And then basically she said, you might have 12 at the maximum 18 months to live. I wasn't offered anything more than that, especially a transplant. As it turned out, we were moving to Queensland. And so this, the doctor, she, I don't know what she looked up. She looked up in her little book, where whatever that might be, someone up here that could take over my hematology. And this was part of the miracle for me. There's a few highlights. She found a doctor at Southport. His name was Dr. Abro. And so when we arrived here, went to visit Dr. Abro, and as it turns out, he not only was a wonderful man and a hematologist, but he actually worked in the Royal Brisbane with Professor Kennedy, who was the head of the hematology department at Royal Brisbane. So I began my treatment with him with blood transfusions and continued with this Vedaza that only lasted for a few months. But after a short time, he said, Russ, he said, I want to send you up to Royal Brisbane to see if maybe you could get through this program. And so that's what happened. Sent me to Royal Brisbane to meet with Professor Kennedy. And I went through a week of tests up there. I went through nearly every department in the Royal Brisbane to see if I could get through. And they said, we think you can make it. So now it was a matter of trying to find a donor. There was no one in Australia. But finally, a donor came through from Germany. And so I had, in June, I went to the Wesley Hospital. But actually, prior to that, I got very sick with pneumonia. And went to a hospital here on the Gold Coast. And I was lucky to come out of that. I was there for 2 weeks. But in the Wesley, I was there for 5 weeks with extensive chemotherapy. I came out for about a month. They sent me back in again because I'd developed leukemia. And I had another lot of chemo. As I say, there's a lot of stuff in between, but eventually I went to Royal Brisbane and I was there. And what they did, they gave me the final lot of chemotherapy that wiped out all my immune system. And so at that stage, I was very, very vulnerable as far as infection was concerned. Because even during that time in the Wesley and with chemotherapy, every time 10% of people don't make it out of there. And then they told Christine and I that only 50% come out of Royal Brisbane with the treatment I was going to get. So you can see it was a little bit concerning. But the wonderful thing was that I had this stem cell transplant. And I created a record. I got out of that department within 17 days. No one had ever got out of the department in that time. And I was sick after that and had to go back in. And then after that, we had 3 months in the Leukemia Foundation at Dutton Park. I had some notes here, but I decided to put that away. And Pastor, basically, all of the, and the other thing, all of the things that they told Christine and I was going to happen to us going through the stem cell transplant, basically never happened to me. And I don't understand that. And there's people today that we still know that are still going through what they call graft versus host, which means there's a fight against your transplant and your body. I've never had any of that. And I don't understand. I've got to say this, that I know I had a lot of people praying for me. And in fact, I remember one day Pastor David Asherick, he prayed with me, and I've never had a prayer like this. And he actually gave a time. He said, "Lord, I want you to heal Russ by January of this next year." And that was the time we came out of hospital and came home after the 3 months in Dutton Park. But what I don't understand, Pastor, and I'll say this, I don't understand, and it's something we need to leave with the Lord, is we don't understand why sometimes people are healed and sometimes they're not. Mm. You know, that's a mystery to us. And I just feel for anyone that has had any sort of cancer and what people go through today. But I thank God.
So I just want to recap a little bit. So you were diagnosed when you were in Sydney. Yep. And basically they gave you, what, a year to 18 months to live. And basically you were too old to get a transplant.
That's right.
Then through these different circumstances that you just explained, you moved up here and you managed to see someone, and they actually said they could give you the transplant. You could get through it.
I was only the second person ever to go through the department in Royal Brisbane that was over 70.
Yeah.
And here I am 6 years later.
6 years. Wow.
And I guess, you know what really worries me, Pastor? What really worries me is that for some reason the good Lord has given me more life. So I've got to pay that back to him. I've got to be willing to do whatever he wants me to do.
Yep. Amen. Well, hopefully that's what all of us want to do. But it is borrowed time. And I just want to pray for you before you go down. Thanks for sharing, Russ. We just want to praise you, God. We want to just thank you for the healing, the amazing testimony of Russell. We also want to thank you for his son. Even though it was a simple thing, we thank you that that had such an impact on his long-term faith. And we pray that that will continue to help him to grow and to continue to trust you. So, Lord, we also want to pray for many today. There are others here today that might have some kind of health diagnosis for themselves, or maybe a friend or something, and we just want to lift them up in prayer. And we just pray that your healing hand will be there for those, and your will be done. And we just thank you for prayer. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for sharing, Russell. So as we get into this topic of prayer, and you know, one of the things that Lockie was originally going to share today, and he's had a lot on, and he said, "Would I do it?" And I love prayer, and I said, "Oh yeah, if I can talk on your topic, I'm happy to, because this is such a crucial part of our journey, and I think it's a part we struggle with. I don't know, there are prayer warriors. Maureen's amazing, and Bridget, our head elder's amazing with prayer, and you know, this journey of this church, what's brought us to be where we are now." You know, it all goes to prayer. You know, 12 years ago, we came to this building, and there was just a core of people here. There was no young people. And, you know, there's been a group that's continued to pray, and God's continued to lead and bless. And I just thank all those that have prayed and continue to pray. And, you know, when I'm finding I'm struggling, and I have to admit, you know, the last few months, I've been struggling. And most of us in the last 2 years with all that's been happening in the world, you know, we've been having some anxiety and questions and maybe things that we're struggling with. And the answer really to all those things is us actually being connected to God through prayer. And we often share that, you know, the spiritual food that we feed on is the bread of life, is the Bible. That's what this is called, God's Word. And this is the spiritual food. It's important that we study and read and feed on God's Word. And, you know, just like our physical food, daily we need it. Well, prayer is even more important than the Word. Because prayer is our direct connection with God. My title was going to be in this sermon, was going to be Prayer Power. But I actually wanted to link three things together, and that is prayer, grace, and thankfulness. Because to me, these are really a link, and these are things that really come through us having that prayer. So prayer, I want to share, and I'll just bring so here in 1 Thessalonians, Paul tells us, always be joyful. You know, what a great thing, you know. And it's great to look out and see smiles. I'm not looking at masks today. And that's been my biggest complaint about this time when we've had to wear masks, is I can't see faces. I can't smile at people and have them smile back to me, or, you know, be able to read their face. They're feeling a bit discouraged or whatever, and be able to go and encourage them and try to speak to them. So praise God that we've got this freedom at the moment. Of course, we don't know what's next. You know, what a crazy world we're living in. You know, look at the past week. You know, the pandemic in Australia, and it's still wild in America. I think it's 1,200 people a day dying over there and other countries as well. You know, there's been earthquakes in Australia, which I did feel an earthquake once in Victoria, so I know they do happen there. There's been a volcano in Spain. And you look at these things on the news, and doesn't it make you, like, you know, think, wow, what's happening? And again, we shouldn't be fearful if we're really connected in prayer. And prayer here, as we read on in this verse, says never stop praying. You know, some translations say pray without ceasing. And that's always kind of puzzled me a little bit. I thought, well, how do we do that? Because I always think of prayer as being this act where I fold my hands, I bow my heads, I close my eyes. And, you know, over my life, and I've gotten to know that it, actually prayer is a state of mind. It's a connection with God. And the comparison I want to tell you is just like the Word of God is the bread of life, prayer is the breath of life. Now, you know, a couple of months ago, we covered about death. And we talked about how a person, God created the body, then he breathed the breath of life into him, and that person became a living being. And so, you know, all of us that are living, breath is crucial. I mean, how long can you hold your breath? You know, not that long. I saw something on TV, someone diving, and I think they could do it 3 or 4 minutes, which is amazing. But, you know, I'd be lucky to get to a minute, probably couldn't. And, you know, that's what prayer should be. If we really want to be spiritually alive, we need to, every second of every day, be praying. And what is it like a physical connection? So that everything we do, every thought we have, we're including God. And so that's what praying without stopping means. So it doesn't mean I'm going around chanting a prayer. It means that, hey, as I interact with people, that God's in that conversation too, as I do things. And this is where it gets tough, because, you know, as I share many times, one of my big battles is on the road. And so, you know, I do actually practice praying when I'm driving, and it actually helps even when I don't need it. But, you know, probably those times when I feel, you know, the blood come to the face and, you know, I get a bit excited, that's especially a time I should pray. Because, you know, prayer, God knows everything. And see, we often look at prayer as being this thing that is very formal. And sure, formal prayer is good, and we do it as a community, but prayer without ceasing is us breathing every breath we take throughout the day, is a breath where God is invited in our lives and being part of who we are and what we do and how we act. You know, what a powerful thing that is, because as Christians, we should be different. That's why we can be joyful. And I love the word joyful for us as Christians, because joy is not based on what happens to us. And as we read on here, the next scripture I have up, this is Paul describing, you know, some of the trials he went through. And he says, are they servants of Christ? I know, and I sound like a madman, But I have served him far more, and I have worked harder, been put in prison more often, been whipped more times without number, and faced death again and again. You know, Paul went, so there's amazing, if you read right through that chapter, he lists all the different things. He'd been shipwrecked and, you know, many things. Paul did not have an easy life. Yeah, but he wrote, you know, my favorite book in the New Testament is Philippians, a little four chapters. But man, it's called, you know, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, it says rejoice, it says there in Philippians 4. And then Paul goes on, he says, then besides all this, I have the daily burden of my concern for all the churches. You know, what was Paul's passion? It was to spread the gospel. And how was he doing that? Through the churches. And I just want to inspire us as a church here on the Gold Coast Central. If you're visiting from another church, that's great too. Whatever church you're part of, we need to be part of the church, part of the body of Christ, working together. And, you know, the challenge is that we've got to do that because we're all different human beings and we have our all different emotions and stuff. And it's good, you know, to get emotional. I'm not having a go at emotions, but we've got to be more than just emotional Christians where we come and we praise God and we worship. That's great. But is that actually live it out in the way we treat others, in the way we treat others and what we say and what we do, especially with those that live closest to us, you know, our children, our moms and dads, our spouses, you know, this is where the challenge is. And as we read on, it says, who is led astray, and I do not burn with anger. If I must boast, I would rather boast about the things that show how weak I am. Now, this is where we as human beings, and I know for me as a male senior pastor of a great church, you know, with a fantastic wife and a wonderful family, you know, I could easily become very proud if I really went down that track. But like Paul, I want to be realize that I am weak. And everything I have is only because of God's grace and his love and him actually just getting me through these things. And, you know, as I look back on my life, you know, it was great hearing Russell Jr.'s spear. And I remember once when I was a kid, I prayed, I lost the lid to the lawnmower. And I prayed, and I remember finding that lid to the petrol on the lid on the lawnmower. And I prayed, and I found it right after I prayed. And that too, like Russ, you know, made an impact on me. But, you know, as I go on through my life, you know, I think time and time again how God's been there for me through car crashes, through this thing and that thing. And I guess the biggest answer to prayer is when God continued to shut doors for me in the States and kept this door open to go to Tasmania. And eventually I made it in 1994, which, you know, really was a true answer to prayer. It was God's leading. You know, he led me to the most wonderful wife, and then we, you know, got married and looked forward to having kids and getting a family. And then we had more challenges. You know, Karen suffered from a disease called endometriosis. If you don't know about that, a lot of women suffer from it, and it's quite painful, and it affects you in lots of ways and also affects your fertility. She had 11 surgeries trying to deal with her, and she lost a tube. And through all this, we're trying to hopefully fall pregnant and have a family. But, of course, nothing was happening. And eventually, after over 5-6 years of that, we began to look down the track of having some help with IVF. So we started doing that when we were still living in Victoria. And, you know, those that I know there's some in this congregation probably been down that track. And especially for the ladies, it's not an easy thing. It's emotionally, it's physically, and tough. Especially when you go through all that and you have no success. And, you know, back then it was not only hard, but it was financially expensive, and we had no success. Well, we moved to south of Brisbane. I became pastor of Parkridge Church in 2004, and we started to continue with IVF up here. And we'd had one or two unsuccessful cycles when we moved up here, and we kind of come to the point, well, God, maybe we're not meant to have children ourselves. But, you know, as you know, my wife loves children. She's great with them. I think I love children, but sometimes my patience needs a little bit more. I like to say I love them, but no, I love children. They're beautiful. But, you know, they do try your patience, I have to be honest. I'm glad because I was actually going to be a school teacher, and I don't know if I'd survive as a school teacher. My hat goes off to you teachers out there. That's tough. But, we went to this, it was big camp, and it must be 2004, so it's around September 2004. We're a big camp up in North Pine, and we left that to go to this information session on adopting. And we went there, and it was this room, this auditorium, and there was probably 200 to 300 people there all wanting to adopt. Now, I don't know if things have gotten any easier. I'm out of touch now, but, you know, I thought, man, this is going to be tough. We listened to all the presentations, and there was a domestic sort of adoption list you can get on, and these are all the requirements and the processes you have to go through and the fee you have to pay. And then there was an international list, which, you know, again, there's not that many on either list that babies that come available. But anyway, we put our names, paid the price to be put on both those lists. And in October, it's only about a month later, Karen was pregnant with our son Samuel, who's now 16. You know, what amazing is her prayer? It was like God just kind of wanted us to come to the point where, hey, we're just going to leave it on you, God, if this isn't meant to be. And then he blessed us. And not only blessed us with Samuel, as you know, a few years later, we're blessed with beautiful twins, Jacob and Matthew, and then my daughter Hannah. So, you know, God is good. And I know that if we shared, we could stay here for days with sharing testimonies. But, you know, we love, it's great, it's powerful to share how God has worked in your life, because that helps other people to be encouraged. And, you know, when you're living through it, sometimes it's hard to see. But as you pray your way through it, you'll always find that God gets you through. And we got to rely on Him. It's about surrender. In Romans 8, 20, 26, this is the wonderful chapter on us, the Holy Spirit, and us relying on it. And it says, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. You know, again, recognizing if we're trying to do life in our own strength, you know, we can do a certain amount, but we're limited. And eventually, it's not going to be enough. We got to rely on God and His Spirit. And for example, we don't know what we want to even pray. And this is where I find very encouraging, because I don't consider myself a person that, I'm not like my wife who preached last week and loves language and loves writing and speaking. You know, language is, you know, for us in Alabama, we just say, how are y'all doing, and keep it very simple. You know, that's the way I approach it. But, you know, are my prayers good enough? And I read this and it says, God's Holy Spirit, what's important is my heart. You know, and sometimes the words don't even come out with what I'm wanting to say, but the Holy Spirit knows truly what I'm trying to say. So, you know, a couple of weeks ago I shared, you know, that Psalms 51 and David pouring out his heart after he'd been confronted with his sin, you know, and God heard him, and God forgave him, and God continued to work in his life. And this is what God does, and the Holy Spirit takes our prayers and with groanings that cannot be expressed and presents them to God perfect. What a wonderful, wonderful God we have. And so I ask today, is prayer a waste of time? Yeah, well, it's not if we're doing it from the heart. Now, if we're just babbling on, like the Pharisees often did in the Bible, you know, if it's just repeating rehearsed prayers, you know, it's prayers that come from the heart. They're certainly not a waste of time. But the thing is, just like reading the Bible, we come to the Bible often wanting to know knowledge and wanting to learn things. And knowledge is great. It's great to know God's Word. But knowledge is not what saves us. We've got to get in that relationship with Jesus. We've got to get to the point that we are actually surrendering to Him and allowing Him to come in and transform us and change us. You know, what a powerful, wonderful thing that is. So prayer is not a waste of time if we do it. As a matter of fact, what is prayer? What's the analogy I used earlier? The breath. So, how we've got to be praying continually. And I love, you know, this church. You know, I've seen it in most churches I've been in. You know, there's people that, you know, often just, can I pray with you? And, you know, even this morning, you know, a couple of people, can we pray with you before you preach? And, you know, what a wonderful thing. You know, sometimes I see out in the foyer, even though it's a bit noisy, occasionally a couple of people praying. You know, wouldn't it be great if there's more of that happening? We need to be people that are connecting and including God and praying and making it something that comes from the heart, and that's not something that we're just kind of asking for things. You know, I often say, you know, people, we use prayer like a genie. If we're struggling with financially or we're struggling with health issues, then we come to God. And yes, we should come to God at those times, but we also got to be praising God and welcoming Him. And the reason we can do that is because the next thing I want to bring up, and I'll just go to, I need to keep going because our next section here is about grace. Because this is how we're able to approach what the Bible says, the throne of grace. Because of Jesus and because He came and made a sacrifice for us, we have direct access through Jesus to God the Father. And that's a wonderful thing, through His grace. You know, I love the word grace, and you know, we always think amazing grace. And that's why that song's so popular, because this is the most amazing Christian concept that comes from the Bible, is that God shows His grace. His grace has given us undeserving love and favor. That we're His child, even though we even reject Him and turn our backs on Him and even curse Him, that He is our God. This is grace. And in Psalms it tells us in 84:11, for the Lord God is our sun and our shield. You know, I love the sun. One of my struggles when I was living in Ballarat for 5 years is I longed to get back to Queensland because I missed the sun. You know, it was so gray, and the sun just really brightens my day. And that's what God should be every day, whether it's a cloudy day or a rainy day, because we have God. He's like the sun in our lives, you know. The sun with S-U-N as well as S-O-N. And He gives us grace and glory. And the Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right. And this is where, it was one of the verses I went through quickly, but it's in the Lord's Prayer where, may thy will be done. And this is what we do have to pray, and this is where Russ was mentioning, well, you know, what about the many people that pray for healing or pray for things and then it's not answered? You know, that's tough. But we have to just pray that there's some reason. God knows what's best, and that's very important when we pray that we do it, may your will be done. But there's one thing for sure that we can guarantee. You know, He might not provide the healing. He might not provide you with the financial help you might need. He might not answer a prayer for someone you're praying for. But one thing's for sure, that He gives you His grace and His love, which connected to that is His eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. You know, that is the good news. The Greek word for grace is charis. The Greek word for thanksgiving is eucharistia. And that's a combination of grace and thanks. So really, grace is connected with thankfulness. So eucharistia is really thanksgiving. And I love, you know, this spirit of thanksgiving. And as I kind of wind it up today, what I want us to do is think about, are we thankful? Are we thankful? Yeah, I described earlier, you know, this world we're living in is pretty crazy, but I think, especially here in Queensland, we've got lots of reasons to be thankful. We don't even have to wear masks today. Just south of the border, you know, they've got, you know, big outbreaks, and I think today I saw the news flash came up that in Victoria, the biggest day yet, 800 and something new cases of this COVID virus. We don't know where this is going to end, but listen, let's be joyful. Let's be thankful for every day we have, because ultimately we know that God's going to give us eternal life with Him. You know, I'm so grateful that we have a God like that. I'm so glad that I can rely on His grace. You know, we don't, whatever we're facing, come and breathe every breath you take. Be a prayer to God that your life becomes this interaction of thankfulness. You know, the attitude of gratitude. You know, that's, I have to work on that. You know, a few weeks ago, again, I shared this really struggle I had with this deal. I missed out on a jet ski, and it wasn't just any deal. Yeah, I haven't forgotten it yet. Ask my wife. But God's helped me to deal with it. Because if He didn't, it'd probably drive me crazy. But listen, you know, I have so much to be thankful for. You know, so what if I missed out on something that might have made me $10,000? Am I short on having food on my table? You know, do I have a wonderful church family? Absolutely. Do I have a wonderful family with a wonderful wife and kids? You know, look at all the things I've got to be grateful for. And listen, sometimes we have to look a bit harder than others, but God wants us to be thankful. You know, in 1 Thessalonians, we always thank God. When? Always. You know? And sure, we say the blessing, well, that's what we call it in America. We call it the blessing before you have a meal here. We call it grace. You know, it's that, those terminology things, you know? You know, I go to the station in America, I get gas. You know, I got to go get some gas. Well, you don't get gas here, you get petrol. But, you know, gas is, I do get gas because my car's on LPG. But, so I can still call it gas. I'm going to the gas station. But, you know, these different things, the important thing is God understands our hearts. And I just want to challenge us all today as we think about, you know, where are we really thankful? You know, here in Timothy, Paul writes to Timothy, he says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has given me strength to do his work. You know, what a great thing to be thankful for. And I just want to praise all the many volunteers and people that contribute and make this church happen. You know, there's so much involved. And, you know, those people are doing, hopefully you're blessed by it. And the more that we can get you involved and get you doing things, you know, it's actually builds community. And it actually gives you satisfaction to know that you're able to do his work. Because we can do a certain amounts of things of our own, but as a church, you know, with this great facility we have, with this great, talented group of people, you know, what amazing more we can do and reach out. And he considered me trustworthy and appointed me to serve him, even though I used to blaspheme the name of Christ in my insolence. You know, Paul, before he became Paul, was Saul. He was persecuting and killing Christians, and he changed. God changed him. But God had mercy on me because I did it in ignorance and unbelief. Oh, how generous and gracious our Lord was. He filled me with the faith and love that come from Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, I don't know what battles you're facing. You know, what is your battle? What is it that's really, you know, this battle, this great conflict, you know, it happened years ago before this world was even created. But then Adam and Eve, they, you know, fell for the deception of the devil, and it brought in this sin problem. And we've been socially distanced from God ever since. And it's not until Jesus comes that that social distance and that barrier is finally going to be broke down. And it's only through Jesus. And I just want to challenge you. Have you invited Jesus into your heart? Have you stepped onto that bridge of Jesus? Are you walking in the way? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And I hope if you haven't made that decision, that you'll make it, but not make it now. That it be made every breath you take. Every breath you take be a connection between you and God. And that he's there on the tip of your tongue, on the edge of your mind, in every thought, everything you do. Let me pray for you as we close today. Lord, I just want to thank you for each person here. Whether they're old or young, Lord, they're your children. You love them. Even if they've kind of gone astray, even if they currently are struggling with having a relationship with you, Lord, I just pray that you'll help them to see that you're longing for them to really surrender to you. Lord, I want to surrender my life to you in a deeper and more meaningful way. Lord, I know there's things like jet skis that get me in the way of really trusting you, knowing that you've got things better for me than some lousy jet ski, Lord. You've got things in store for us that is beyond our imagination. May we accept what we have, and may we live grateful lives. May we be thankful for the things that we can be thankful for, and know the things that are challenging and are hard, that you're going to be there to help us through it, that you promise never to leave us and never forsake us. So, Lord, I just lift up every person to you. Whatever battle they're facing, know that they're not fighting it alone. The battle's really between God and Satan, and, Lord, you won it on the cross when Jesus died. And, Lord, we thank you that we can claim victory, because we choose today to be on your side. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we hear the stories of our brothers and sisters as they share their experience with God, and as we look at Scripture and even in our own lives, we can see that God is there. So let's make that bold declaration that he lives. Please stand as we sing about our wonderful God.
and Savior is in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. I know the heart grows weary, I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. Ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. Welcome. Oh, welcome. Where did that come from? I knew I had to do something. Well, we'd like to say thank you for everyone who's come today. We have a special birthday coming up on Friday, the 1st of October. Phil Cameron. Do you know Phil Cameron is turning 91? Yeah. Phil is sitting there in the corner, and we would just like to say, Phil, where are you? Happy birthday for Friday. We can only aspire, and we hope that you have a wonderful birthday. We'd also like to remind you of the prayer requests corner. If you have any special reason that you'd like somebody to pray for you, sometimes we get a bit run down in our own prayers and we want somebody to just take the baton for us and give an extra special prayer, you're welcome to come over.
Any South Africans in the house, you may want to come down for special prayer for tonight.
Rugby union stuff. Okay. The All Blacks clearly don't need any prayer. Thank you for coming, everyone. Have a happy week.